Hello and welcome. In this video, I will use the development of the Greater Pearl River Delta region in China as an example to demonstrate the interaction between policy and governance as well as urban growth. In 2015, this region, with a total population of around 60 million, has overtaken Tokyo to become the world's largest urban area in both size and population, according to a report from the World Bank. This area is almost 40,000 square kilometers. It produces almost 10% of China's GDP and has annual GDP growth of 10%. The Greater Pearl River Delta region includes 9 large cities in mainland China and 2 special administrative regions, Hong Kong and Macau. It's one of China's 3 main economic hubs and reputedly a world factory. The region's industrialization has been an impetus for its massive urbanization, attracting millions of migrant workers to the region for manufacturing jobs. In comparison with the gradual evolving process of polycentric urban regions in Europe, the Pearl River Delta region grows faster in speed and is much bigger. Consequently, the policy orientations and action perspectives of the Greater Pearl River Delta region and the European regions can be expected to diverge as well. Hong Kong, Shenzhen and Guangzhou are 3 dominant economic players in Greater Pearl River Delta region and tend to compete for a leading role within the region. Each city has a distinctive development path following its own specific context and governance approach. It is interesting to ask the question, how policy and government influence the growth of these cities. Hong Kong's history as a British colony from the 19th century allowed it to develop a distinctive institutional and legal system and a free market. Hong Kong's laissez-faire capitalism is often described as a stateless capitalism. The Hong Kong government has an explicit policy of positive non-intervention. Don't interfere with the market. Albeit subtle and indirect, Hong Kong's economic development reveals the decisive role of the state in creating conditions for growth and competitiveness since the 1950s. For example, the government owns all urban land. The land is leased in a land market entirely controlled by government. This land regime not only helps the government to obtain substantial public revenue, but also allows Hong Kong to pursue its public transport-oriented development approach by integrating transportation and land use planning. The compact and highly efficient urban development approach allows 90% of all passengers to travel by public transportation. About 42% of the territory's households, 43% of the employment population, and 75% of the commercial and office floor areas are all located within a radius of 500 meters of railway stations. Another result of this approach is a highly quality living environment. That 3/4 of Hong Kong's total 1,100 square kilometers of land is countryside, and 40% of total land area is protected for conservation and recreation. Until the late 1970s, manufacturing flourished in Hong Kong, and it became a major entry port in Pacific Asia. China's post-1978 reform policies allowed Hong Kong firms to relocate across the border to benefit from lower labor costs, resulting in the so-called hollowing out of Hong Kong as a manufacturing center. Hong Kong took advantages from its flexible financial regulations, its extraordinary communication and business infrastructure, its networks of connection to develop itself as an international financial center. Hong Kong has played an important role in the history of China and Chinese miracles, as most investment in China circulates through Hong Kong. Hong Kong has become indispensable to China's incorporation into the global economy. In contrast, both Shenzhen and Guangzhou have experienced rapid economic growth, industrialization, and urban expansion as a result of strong state intervention. Both cities tried to take advantages from their adjacent location to Hong Kong and attract investment and industries with a special economic zone policy designed by the central government. Shenzhen is a representative example in this Chinese polycentric urban region that grows rapidly. Shenzhen has arisen from a fishing village with a rice field to become the testing ground for importing foreign capital, technology, management, knowledge, and talents. The national government has actively supported Shenzhen in fulfilling this privileged role. In 1980, Deng Xiaoping proclaimed Shenzhen as a national special economic zone. In the earlier years, Shenzhen focused on building export-oriented economy and became the manufacturing center in China. With around 3,000 inhabitants in 1950, its official population was 12 million in 2005, and is expected to reach 50 million by 2030. Since 1980, Shenzhen's urbanization rate increased from 28% to 85%, making it one of the most densely urbanized cities in China. Shenzhen's GDP growth at annually 27% between 1980 and 2006. It was also the place where the first overseas bank established its presence, the first post-1949 stock market, and hosted the headquarters of numerous high-tech companies. Due to rising land and the production costs and the regional competition, traditional labor-intensive and low-value-added industries have been gradually replaced by more knowledge-intensive, high-value-added ones, such as high-tech, finance, foreign trade, shipping, and creative industries. Shenzhen wants to departure from its image as manufacturer base to focus more on its future image, ecological system, environment, and innovation. In the Guangzhou case, both central government's open-door policy and the local government's mega-event strategies shaped the city's urban growth. Guangzhou was considered China's South Gate and certainly one of its oldest cities. It is the political, economic, educational, and cultural capital of Guangdong province, as well as a strong international trade center. As one of the 14 coastal open cities, Guangzhou could grasp the opportunity to revitalize its commercial function by creating Guangzhou Economic and Technological Development Zone to attract foreign investment. Hosting the 6th and 9th National Games and 2010 Asian Games has provided the city with an opportunity to establish the city's new urban districts with central business district facilities and advanced transportation infrastructures. These developments pushed the expansion of Guangzhou towards eastern and southern sides. Strategic projects currently under implementation in Guangzhou linked to urban innovation and sustainable development, such as Sino-Singapore Guangzhou Knowledge City and Nansha New Area. Despite their enormous urban growth, all three cities encounter the challenge of economic restructuring to maintain their competitiveness within the region. The three cities compete for port activities and for financial and high-tech sector. All cities now emphasize livability issues like affordable housing, clean environment, and social equality in its urban strategy. Fragmented regional coordination resulted in the delay or suspension of a number of regional integration measures, such as the inter-region high-speed train system or bridges. For example, the Hong Kong-Macau-Zhuhai Bridge project left Shenzhen out after 20 years of negotiation due to the objection of Hong Kong. Shenzhen, fearing it will be left out of the connection, decided to build its own bridge connecting to the West Pearl River Delta region. The same fragmentation in regional coordination can also be found in environmental or resource redistribution issues. If the three cities want to further develop in a sustainable way, regional coordination between local states and in coordination with national and regional government, like the Guangdong provincial government, becomes more essential. Observing the development path of the three cities in the past decade, we see not only different layers of government which have played a role, but also that other stakeholders within the city have got a stronger voice. In Hong Kong, contrary to the view of Hong Kong government and the business sector, strong public sentiment oppose or hesitate to integrate with the mainland cities in the Greater Pearl River Delta region. Some even hope Hong Kong can maintain its competitiveness without any regional collaboration. In Shenzhen, the local authorities fear little progress will be made in regional collaboration with Hong Kong. They have decided to develop a new central business district in Qianghai area without coordinating any possible competition with Hong Kong, albeit hesitation from the business sector. In Guangzhou, both government capacity and business interests in new development were lacking, leaving the new development of Sino-Singapore Guangzhou Knowledge City slow in progress. Looking back at the development path of the three cities, it's clear that Hong Kong has tended to establish its image as a financial hub by claiming its Asia's global city status. Shenzhen has developed the profile of a stronger technologically driven and innovation-oriented city, but ambitious to be more than just China's special economic zone. Meanwhile, Guangzhou's identity is somewhat more generic and traditionally leaning on the idea that it is China's South Gate, but faced trouble on establishing future image. To conclude, the growth city achieved is strongly linked to their power and capacity to address economic, spatial, social, and environmental issues in an integrated manner, while making the most of future opportunities. The development path of the three cities shows how policy and governance structure influence urban development process and urban growth. We see that the context and dynamics of individual cities heavily influence the type of vision, strategies, and implementation put in place to achieve sustainable urban growth. At policy level, we see cities choose different state intervention. In Hong Kong case, the role of the local government is indirect, aiming at creating an enabling environment for a free market environment. Shenzhen and Guangzhou, on the other hand, demonstrate how government at different levels can influence urban growth through policies. Shenzhen's Special Economic Zone is a national project designed by the central government. Guangzhou's development, especially the exploration of mega-event strategy, is more directed by the local government. However, from a governance point of view, in all three cases, we see that projects are facing difficulties or are being suspended as a result of societal objection or lack of interest from a business sector. How to convince the market players and the societal forces to develop in a joint force, and how to coordinate different layers of government? This will be the biggest challenge for these cities.